Yeah.
Thank you.
Well, that is a good question, isn't it? Maybe to everyone who helped to nearly kill me and then resurrect me. A little changed, but at least alive. Yeah, all those readers who made me possible. Not only to philosophers who read holding their heads in their hands while developing complicated theories about the world. Not only to those old Greeks with their parchments unrolling into their laps, but also people who prefer to read with the book on their knees, people who prefer to lie down on the bed, on the sofa, people who read on the balcony so that they can peep at pretty boys going down the lane, people that cannot resist and read the final page of the book first, people that cannot start the day till they read every single sentence of the newspaper, including the obituaries, lovers who read to one another, students reading before an exam, a teacher to a student, a mother to a child, to all the people who read in buses, in prisons. Oh, and I've been there. Whoever reads to learn, whoever reads to forget, to pass time, to endure, to resist, to discover, or to move on, whoever, well, yeah, whoever, I, a humble native from Flatland, dedicate to you, inhabitants of space in general, and to you, solid readers in particular, in front of this book, at this very moment. Yeah, you there thinking, oh, maybe I should have gone to have a beer instead of coming here this evening. Or you, thinking about your new lover. Or you, thinking about somebody else's lover who you know you shouldn't be thinking about. Well, whatever you're thinking, I count on you to turn each one of these pages, wishing that just as I was introduced through reading into the mysteries of three dimensions, having been given only two, that you shall slowly begin to understand the bi-dimensional world and discover the insights of Flatlanders, and that in this way, we can change the course of history through laws of fiction. But boy, can we read books. We can slide over the outline of the letters and follow the labyrinths of lines that make up each word and sentence, and in this way follow the stories written in any book made of flat pages. But in fact, for a Flatlander, it's natural and considered one of the most exciting sports. It's a bit like swimming and diving after throwing yourself into endless corridors of playground slides, while competing as a gymnast at the Olympics on every apparatus at the same time, simultaneously doing your taxes, cooking a three-course meal for the entire family, while making love to your wife, and preparing a brilliant financial analysis for a company that's about to go bankrupt. Yeah, but we'll get to that later. Life used to be simple. I lived in a very ordinary house, like this one. On a street like this, in a suburb of a city like this, in a little country like this. Everything was made out of simple lines going north, south, east, west, or in any of the 360 degrees that encompassed our world. Look, every day I got up direction south, got dressed diagonally southeast, while complaining to my wife, still southwest in bed, that I didn't have any iron shirts for the day. I ate my breakfast, brushed my teeth, northwest, northeast, northwest, northeast. Remembering I really should make an appointment with my dentist for a checkup, and went out, always heading north. At the end of the day, and on the weekends, me and my family used to walk through groups of letters like... Even visit exciting foreign emotions like Schadenfreude,
Saudade, Tristesse,
Pathos,
Wabi-sabi. There were no such things as solids, volumes, textures, or problems such as time or space. To know the distance between the line of a house, for example, and the line of a tree, we would calculate the amount of blurriness surrounding those lines. Now, the blurrier,
the further away.
This was one of those basic principles of distance in Flatland that prevented people and things like thump, bumping into each other all the time. It was very practical, and no one ever bothered to ask themselves why. Oh, actually, while we're kind of talking about practical matters, I guess some of you are trying to imagine what I look like. Since you have one more dimension than me, you cannot see me, the same way I cannot see you, since I have one dimension less than you. Or, no, actually, hang on. That might be the reverse. Since I have one dimension less than you, you cannot see me, and I cannot see you, since you have one more dimension than me. But anyway, what I look like is very simple. Now, you are reading a book right now, right? Now, imagine I'm here beside the letter X. There is no letter X in that sentence. Okay, what's a good sentence with the letter X? My friend Xavier, well, no, that is an X, but it sounds like a Z. E aqui no Portugal é X, é muito complicado. I really need to go to the doctors for an X-ray. Well, that's a little bit overdramatic, and actually I never need to go for an X-ray for anything, really. I've got one, all right. Now, you are reading a book right now, right? Now, imagine I'm here inside the axis, the axis of the two lines that make up the letter X. Now, a little bit below that, you'll see the shape of a triangle. Now, some of you are probably saying, oh, I see four unfinished triangles. That's not what I'm talking about. Ignore that. There, inside the axis, what you'll see is like a diamond shape, okay? And then you cut the diamond shape in half, and you get a triangle. Now, what you have to do is imagine that you can lower your eyes to the level of the page, which is probably quite tough for you 3D guys to do. So why don't we just tilt the X there? There we go. Okay. And now you come very close to our flat condition and how we look at things. Except the difference is that I'm very, very, very small. So you have to imagine the line shorter. Imagine it shorter. And so short, in fact, that to your eyes I look like, well, not much when I'm on my own. But if you get a lot of us together... I was talking about reading. It's an amazing sport, especially because it's always varied and you can get all sorts of different emotions besides getting technically very good at it. Now, for example, if you're in good shape, you can sport read whole paragraphs in one go. Well, but it's tricky. I once saw my cousin fall all the way from the top of a page of the Brothers Karamazov, not stopping until he was halfway through chapter 2 of Germaine Greer's The Female Eunuch, where he was impaled on one of the L's that make up the word phallus. When he finally regained consciousness, he didn't even realize that he had changed gender of author, let alone thematic content. That was a paragraph where Hermes Trismegistus explains the whole idea of decomposition of a body in search of gold, which is page 37 of the Opus Magnum, if you're one of those people still searching for their own particular inner worth. And the next second, I can be sliding in a totally different landscape, such as this. Now, that was part of the electrical theory by Giordano Bruno, which I am very deeply into these days, and one of the reasons why he was burned alive by the Inquisition. It's fun to slide through the boudoir of Camille, or 200 pages of Tolstoy's Battles, while my son is caught in a tornado with Dorothy as her house is lifted out of Kansas and transported to Oz, while my wife... Yeah, well, my wife is more into social realism and reads things like The Life of Rural Women in 18th Century Ireland, Volume 2. Yeah, we don't really see eye to eye on reading matter, my wife and I. But the meeting point at the end of the day was always in an Ian Fleming novel, one of our favorite stories to slide through. And we would always end the day there with a competition. Storyboarding. Yeah, to see who could hold on as long as possible, sliding non-stop until the end of the page, arrive there first, and hope for the page to be turned. Okay, shall we give this a go? Now, James Bond has crashed his Aston Martin and he's been captured by Goldfinger and they've strapped him to this large metal table and we don't really know what's going on because above his head there's this huge apparatus and it's not till it's switched on we realise it's a laser beam! And it starts cutting up the table up between James Bond's legs and we're sliding down the page and we don't know whether James Bond is going to live or die and we're hoping and praying and waiting for that great miracle of flat nature to occur, the turning of the page. But we're getting near the bottom of the page and I don't really feel like anything's going to happen, so I'm going to double back a couple of paragraphs and James Bond has crashed his Aston Martin. Oh no! And I've gone back too far, and now my wife is ahead of me and my son ahead of me, and I'm going to skip a couple of adverbs and a subjunctive clause, and now we're sliding down and James Bond is still strapped to the table and the laser beam is still cutting up between his legs and it's getting very close to his private and secret agent parts, and he's beginning to look around nervously and he's looking at Goldfinger saying, "You don't expect me to talk to you, Goldfinger," and Goldfinger's looking at him saying, "No, Mr. Bond, I expect you to die," and we're sliding down and then we feel like it's like a rustling or a flapping, it's a flapping of a breeze, it grows, and yes, yes, here we go, here we go, here we go, here we go, into the next page. It's the most incredible feeling. It's like you get to the top of a roller coaster and you drop so quickly on the other side that you leave your stomach behind and you don't know whether you're going to laugh hysterically or throw up on the person that's sitting next to you. It's the most fantastic feeling that you can possibly imagine. And sorry, I'm getting a little bit carried away there. But no, really, it's quite marvelous and you should try it for yourself if you possibly can. And chapter 2, the code. Carry on. Lazily sliding for a bit of relaxation, I accidentally discovered a strange letter like this. I thought it was such an amazing letter with so many lines and swirls and squiggles that no doubt it had to have a lot of meanings. I took what you would call a lot of time in your world to memorize this amazing letter and started investigating it. At dinner, I discussed and shared my ideas with my family. My wife thought it was just another one of my weird hobbies. And my son at the age of 8 appears to be a post-modernist and kept telling me, "Daddy, it's a landscape letter. It's not meant to be decodified." And still, I persisted with my investigation, and still today I wish I'd never paid that much attention to it. Maybe I'd be happier, though more ignorant today. But at the time, I could not know what kind of tragedy I was getting into. It was a Sunday. I was a bit bored, you know, sliding around at random, and I couldn't settle on any one thing in particular to read. And I ended up in a police report. I discovered this. I could not believe what my body line was sliding through. This strange letter was a fingerprint. Well, I know what a fingerprint is. I had just not slid through one before. But that's not the issue. The issue here is that for me to be able to find a fingerprint in Flatland, there has to have been a contact between this suspect and my world. But a fingerprint requires a finger. And a finger requires a hand, and hands need to be linked to arms, and arms, well, they don't just float around without bodies, and they should all have a head on top and legs below, and they usually come with feet attached. It's like, a real person, just like James Bond. So this meant that somewhere James Bond, complete with martinis, beds, Blonde girls to go in the beds, submarine cars with sophisticated gadgets, laser watches, creepy guys with bad teeth and midgets with razor hats and so forth, all really existed. Every single thing that I had ever come across while sportively reading actually existed already somewhere else. And everything that was written was true. Oh, you cannot imagine how devastated, how flabbergasted I was. Because arms and legs and chests and fingers and toenails and pretty blonde girls in round beds and dry martinis must be pretty normal in your life. You pretty much start from that when you're born. But imagine a simple guy like me, all right, a simple dot like me, no need to rub it in, that suddenly realizes the house he's cared for is nothing but a design for a 3D one in your world. Huh, a map, yeah, a detailed guide to one of your real cities. The clothes I wear are only patterns to make better ones in beautiful fabrics I have read about, but never imagined really existed. And every single sentence I had ever read in my life was actually an N registration of what is really happening in another dimension. My life was fake. And James Bond was out there living the real one. I almost collapsed. Then, seriously ill, I couldn't even read. That would give me nausea. But then I decided it was my mission to make Flatland a better place. I formulated my concept of the third dimension and called a press conference to tell all my flatmates about what I had discovered. Oh, I presented it to a very surprised audience, imagining I would be celebrated for my discoveries. Instead, I was dragged away by flat police landers who accused me of taking reading sports too seriously and disturbing the peace and tranquility of Flatland. Convicted of violating the basic principles of citizenship and geometry of Flatland. Only allowed to sport read twice a day, under the strict supervision of a flat therapist, or to keep my body line in reasonable shape, and ensure my return to normal flat thinking. Now this is when I learned how to read between the lines, and pretend I was only sport reading when I was actually doing secret research to save my reputation and prove there was another dimension out there by developing a 3D model in a 2D world. Oh, I can give you a pretty good example of how reading between the lines works. You see? Oh yeah, you see. All communication between the readers of an image and the makers of an image takes place on a two-dimensional surface. Communication is nearly always carried on a 2D level. And that was what had bothered me for so long. What were you doing here? What were you doing here? What were you doing here? Spacelanders go to Flatland in order to transform and perfect information that can be used in their 3D world. Oh, but what if we Flatlanders wanted to have space in Flatland too? Well, that would require a dimensional expansion never dreamed of before, wouldn't it? Well, I thought and thought and thought about these two worlds and realized that if the written world had been invented by Spacelanders, then everything that happens in 3D world must go through 2D world first. And this means that letters are codes to produce space. Somewhere in all the reports, books, articles, and other bi-dimensional documentation, the transformation processes are described in detail. I just had to do it backwards. It was just a matter of finding the right formula. Well, I decided to be very practical and dedicate my research to finding out more about the mysterious fingerprint beings and find what qualities they have that I don't have. I started comparing everything I read to everything I have. This way, I would arrive by an empirical process of comparison and elimination to a list of empirical elements that would only exist in Spaceland, and this way find the empirical components I needed to create an empirical 3D model in Flatland. It's clear enough, obviously. So, okay. What have they got? Well, they've got space. Well, obviously, they've got space. They're space people. That's what they've got, space. So, all right, basics. Well, they've got tall people and small people. Well, no, we've only got small people, very small people. But size doesn't matter. Now, my wife says size doesn't matter. So, well, basically, we are the same. But you have more. But what more? Well, I studied this list over and over to find which of the mores would make the important difference between us and you. And suddenly I realized it was movement. Of course, I can only go north, south, east, west, north, east, north by northeast, southwest, south by southwest, and any of the millions of different directions in between. But you can go up and down. And to be able to do that, you need to have volume. Only things that have volume can jump up and then fall down. Volume and movement. Volume and movement. My 360-degree lifestyle was shattered. Well, I started immediately trying to create volume by launching things above myself. Oh, but that's not an easy task to accomplish in Flatland. Things don't fly, and things don't fall in my world. That's why we don't have duck hunting. But where could I keep volume if I had volume in Flatland? I would need a box to keep my volume in. And a box is just a cube. So I tried making a cube by dislocating a square so many times that I could tie the different layers together and then gradually compress them until I could create a cube. And then I searched in a dictionary for a similar image to see if it had all the same qualities as in Spaceland. And that's when I read cube in perspective. And I thought, perspective. A. Art of drawing solid objects on a flat surface so as to give the right impression of their height, width, depth, and position in relation to each other. B. Representation of a three-dimensional space in a two-dimensional reality. This was becoming a nightmare. Well, you had already invented cubes like the one that took me so long to build. Oh, you not only use me to reason about information, but you also want to make me look like you without allowing me to be you. Oh, for you, I'm just a representation of your reality. Okay, I only wanted to make a simple model of the 3D world in Flatland, but now the game was something else. I wanted to talk to you. I wanted to make some things clear. I wanted to become 3D. Well, if everything in my world is a representation of yours, then the key to access your construction is hidden in my landscape. I bet you didn't think of that, huh? Well, it was clear. I had to get out of prison. There was not much more I could do in there. I started planning my escape, not only out of prison, but out of Flatland completely. But just as I was about to finish, I was unexpectedly released on parole. Well, my reading between the lines had looked like good behavior. Oh, I had been a model prisoner. And when I went home, I found out my keys didn't fit the lock. My wife was gone, and she'd taken the kids. My friends didn't want to speak to me anymore. My bank account was frozen. Well, the main condition of my parole was that I find a job. But you know how these things go when you have a record. I slid and slid through letters at random. Until finally, I arrived at the bottom line, which in Flatland means you get to the horizon line. And after that, only a great blank is ahead of you. Well, you avoid going there at all costs unless you're as desolate as I was. I went there to put an end to my lifeless life. But to my surprise, I found a notice saying, all I had to do to get a good salary, bed and breakfast, was to cross the corner of the Flatland border, deliver something, come back. Oh, and not ask too many questions about where I was going. But what did I have to lose? Without a blink or a second thought, I jumped into the mysteries of the vanishing point business. First, they give you a uniform and a flat bag, and they tell you not to lose it. And then they order you to go to the corner of the horizon line. Close your eyes. Stay perfectly still. Wait for something. Well, so you wait, trying to stand still. But you cannot stand still because a strong wind starts pushing you towards the vanishing point. Well, now you're really fighting to stay still, but then you lose the hat, and desperate not to lose it, you drop the suitcase to try and grab it. Well, then you lose the suitcase. You manage to grab that, but it falls open, and it's full of letters that get blown everywhere. Then piece by piece, you're taken away. Your lines, your shape, your headings, your footnotes, your punctuation. And while you're fighting to recover everything, you seem to lose more and more, until at last you lose your ability to think. And at a certain moment, you are propelled into a world of blinding light, where the vanishing point depends upon your point of view, and no matter how far you run, is always where you are not. Then, suddenly, the lights would recede, and you were back in Flatland. No suitcase, no uniform, no hat, no idea what has happened to you. And because they have warned you beforehand that that should not ever happen, you are forced to work more the next day to pay for the uniform and hat and suitcase you lost. Next day, exactly the same thing happens. Each time you come back, you have lost more and more, but you are unable to stop since you have so many debts to pay. Although it was an amazing experience to go to this job, it was a terrible one to come back. When I was returning, an enormous triangular gate was closed across the horizon line. I was prevented from getting in, and it was too late to go back into this other place. Well, I didn't know then, but I realize now that somebody had stopped reading. The corner of the page was folded over. Who could have done something so dangerous to me? Now listen, in slow motion, I looked back and I saw a leftover particle of light aiming right at me. Well, I didn't know if it was a good particle or a bad particle. I guess I panicked, you know, fight or flight. All I knew was that a ray of light was coming straight at me, and I had just a fraction of a second to instinctively slide along the right side of the horizon line and get back to Flatland through the bottom corner of the page. So, without planning it, I was set free from my shitty job, and I was on the opposite side of my country, a totally deserted place with soft wind and only one or two letters flying around. One bar. Oh, and very conveniently, one library. I started researching again. Some habits you never forget. Are you getting this? Oh, yeah, that's right. You can't read the way I do. Okay, well, I'll spare you the details, and I'll go straight to the point and purpose of this evening. No, actually, I have to give you some details, or else you won't understand what I'm talking about. Okay, Euclides believed in intromissions. No, you probably need a bit more information than that. Okay, Euclides thought that from the eyes of observers, there are rays which are launched into space. They're like fine grains of looking atoms that melt and capture all the information that's being observed. Now, the rays, they spread and mix with the particles of air. They cover all the surfaces and steal their images and transfer them back into the brains of the people with fingerprints. This is like a constant rain. This is what I had seen when I was trapped outside the horizon line. Those were observational rays coming at me. And that means behind those rays, there were eyes. And around those eyes, there were 3D bodies. Of course, I was going to Spaceland every time I was going to work. Unbelievable. How did I not think of this before? Every time I was going to work, I was going to the third dimension. Pulled by the act of observation from the other side. You were making me go to the third dimension, and once you stopped looking, I would go back. Well, of course, I could not connect this foreign country with Spaceland, because the lights were always off on your side, so I could not see you, and the lights were always on my side, so you could always watch me. Lights, words, movement on my side, darkness and silence on the other. Well, how could I suspect that the light I was feeling was the light of your looking? And that's why I was so tired. You steal my image every time you look at me. We're so close, yet we cannot communicate. An audience full of James Bonds leaving their fingerprints on their martinis while looking at me. And the reason why I was feeling strangely alive in your world was because I was being seen. Oh, never mind to be or not to be. To be is to be seen. And if I could force you all to watch me all the time, I would be all the time, right? If I could kidnap all of you, right here, right now, and perform for you forever so you would stay right there, right now, watching me all the time. Interesting. If I could kidnap all of you. Interesting. Well, I realized I had to get back to my shitty job. I turned myself in, and I apologized for my sudden disappearance. I told the boss that I had the flu, actually, but he didn't seem to mind. Apparently, people disappeared and reappeared all the time in this job. But I was given the hardest travels and the longest hours as a punishment, just as I wanted. Well, I went to space thousands of times, and each time I got better and better at detaching myself from my job. Each time I arrived inside space a little bit earlier and always tried to stay a little bit longer than planned. But each time I went, I bravely stared into the rays of light, teaching myself to focus. Well, the first time I ever managed to see anything, I had to run away almost immediately because I could not handle the light. But the next time, I took a pair of sunglasses to protect myself. I arrived, and I was about to see myself, but my humble shape was fragmenting, I hung on as long as possible, trying to watch myself perform a role, but my body could not handle the pressure. And finally, I arrived much too early. The lights were still off on my side and on your side. I couldn't believe it. The place was filled with forms. Some were looking for a seat, some were talking, some came from, I don't really know where they came from, outside, I guess. Some were reading little librettos. I recognized expressions, movements, intentions, even skirts and jackets. But they seemed to be, and I know this sounds a little bit crazy, but they seemed to be fatter or thicker, somehow deeper. Well, I focused even more. I wanted to stay longer when the lights went off on my side. Everyone left their seats. With no one left to look at me, I was back in Flatland in no time. But then, on my last trip, I arrived at a somber-looking room with big black letters saying Anatomical Amphitheater. By this time, I could perfectly detach myself from my job and watch myself being watched while working. What I mean to say is, it was the first time I saw both sides at the same time. What you look like as spectators and what I look like as a worker in my shitty job. Now there I was, on stage as a naked man lying on a table. Next to me was another man surrounded by metal instruments. Now remember, I can't see like you do. It's just lines and blurriness, but I can assure you this was pretty close to what was actually happening. Now this other man was approaching me and he was ready to cut my chest open. Well, he did that, and then he took out a layer of fat and then some strange slippery objects that he called lungs, kidneys, liver, stomach and other stuff. He put them all to one side and he cut them into very thin slices which he examined very carefully. On the other side, watching, there was a row of you dressed just like this first man, mostly silent. Doctors. In the second row, you were students taking notes. A third row of you, the bourgeoisie. And at last, in the final rows, you, normal audience, probably full of typical James Bonds. Well, from there, I turned my attention back to me as a naked body. It was then that I understood the man was dead. Vesalius, the doctor who was dissecting my body, was explaining bit by bit how nothing was functioning anymore and how it used to function. I started crying. Well, I realized I must be dead. Well, because people in real life written about in books, when they don't have a body, they're dead. Well, for the first time, it was me who wanted to leave this place. But for as long as you were watching me, I had to stay. Flat tears were rolling down my linear face, and for some time I was unable to even think. Well, eventually I pulled myself together. Hey, life's too short for complaints, even if you are already dead. And I started memorizing all the steps taken by Vesalius in his anatomical lecture. And once the class was dismissed and the lights went off, I returned to Flatland, completely exhausted. But instead of going right home and taking a good rest as usual, I stayed there on the edge of the blank and I performed an autopsy on myself. Well, to find out why I was dead and to see if I could change this awful state of being. Well, I cut myself in a million different ways and in a million different directions, but could not find any evidence that I had ever had volume in my life. Well, from there, it gets a bit hazy, but they told me later that I collapsed and was rushed to intensive care in Flatland, where they diagnosed I was suffering from exhaustion and that my lines were fading away. They prescribed bed rest and line restoration with carbon HB14, normally used only as a restorative for very old or very sick flat people. And although it's very effective, it causes severe hallucinations. I had a dream. Space was an optical illusion, and life a slow process of combustion. I was looking at you, and you were looking at me. The particles of your eyes came right at me, and the wind they created moved the particles around me and built a net that created veins, and the veins led to the lungs where I was sliding through an artery into a heart described by Da Vinci. And to get a body, you need a breath, you need a beat. To get a body, you need a breath, you need a beat. But you cannot show up just like this to the 3D people. It would be very unpleasant. And in my dream, I slid through as many books as possible, and the Sibyls told me to borrow the prophecy of Edward Muybridge so I could run. But still, I didn't move. To get a body, you need a breath, you need a beat. It would be easy to be a ghost, but since you've never been a person before, it's quite hard to be one. Start like this. Decompose a borrowed body. Divide, dissect, dissolve, distill. Divide, dissect, dissolve, distill. There is a quick way or a humid way to reach a charge of 50. Bathe in a mercurial process. Divide, dissect, dissolve, distill. Sulfurous, fixation, opera, philosophica, mineralia, cinematographica, limelight, arc light. I had created an electrical phantasmagoria, plugged in, switched on, and projected life-size. Limelight, arc light. The particles of your eyes were the essential fuel to make me move. And there I was, a Leonardo drawing in disguise, an artificial ghost with a heart condition and the body of a dissected criminal. And there I was, Frankenstein in the skin of James Bond with the heart of a little girl from Kansas. I woke up! I was looking at you. You were looking at me. The action seemed the same. Therefore, I thought we had become the same. But actually, you had become like me. You had stolen my desires and had begun sending yourselves to each other through electricity, through waves, through cable. You sent yourselves printed to postboxes. You sold yourselves to you on every corner in every magazine. You fixed yourselves on every wall of the city. Your reality only judged real when seen at a distance and reported back to yourself second by second in real time. Well, you were so busy spreading the news about yourselves. You were so busy playing yourselves. You started needing a gaze everywhere. You could no longer live without being watched. On every corner, in every shop, in every entrance of a museum, a cinema, a cash machine, a bank, a garden, you were under surveillance by yourselves. But still, millions of spacelanders bought tickets to hide in the darkness of cinemas and theaters. The privilege of seeing and not being seen. Still existing. I was looking at you, and you were looking at me. The action seemed the same. I realized my job was already done. I had kidnapped you already. And in the strangest Stockholm syndrome ever, you had become flat. And stranger still, as long as I look human enough, I can survive in Spaceland. Well, there are always TVs, surveillance cameras, webcams, scanners in the world. There'll always be someone watching me. My new task is to find the equation of darkness and discover how to live without a look. How to become as privileged as you, observers, that can still exist without being looked at. It's funny. Some people live in windy places, constantly daydreaming about wonderlands, while dreamworlders often wish for thunderstorms. Thank you.
horror.